Join us now for Let's Just Talk with Kathryn Raaker.
Hi, this is Kathryn Raaker of Let's Just Talk TV, and I have a wonderful show for you tonight. I have two wonderful friends. I have Father Reverend Andrew Umberg from St. Joseph's Parish in North Bend, and a Bible scholar, and Patricia Sternkorb, author, television personality, my partner in the Bible Comes to Life program, and myself, Kathryn Raaker. And tonight we're going to be talking about one of the most exciting programs that I can think about. And Pat and I have shared in this program as far as going to Israel. And that's what we're going to be talking about, how the Bible relates to and why it's so important to go on a pilgrimage and to see Israel and live the Bible. The Bible Comes to Life. Just recently, Pat and I were appointed travel liaisons for the Bible Comes to Life program. And Father, I'm so excited that you're here today because, you know, when we first met, you came on my radio show a long time ago, and you were so exciting, and now you're on my radio show as a regular, and you're so good at the Bible. I love it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I try my best. I studied a lot.
I want to ask you a couple of questions before Patty and I start talking about this, and we have you talk as well. Tell me, you've been a priest for how long?
25 years now.
Really? You don't look that old. Just
<Thank you>.
Teasing. Just teasing. But what I was going to say is you not only are a pastor, but you do something with seminarians. Can you tell us what you do?
I was in seminary work for a long time. Now I'm involved in the ongoing education of priests.
And you love that, don't you?
I do.
And tell me, you also love teaching the Bible, and especially the New Testament. Am I correct?
Yes, although I like teaching the Old Testament, too. It's just so important. As one of the popes has said, as St. Jerome, the doctor of the church, had said, ignorance of Scripture is ignorance of Christ. So I want my people, of course, to know Jesus, to know
right.
the Lord Jesus, and that's knowing the Scripture to a great extent.
Right. And, you know, Pat, we went to Israel firsthand in 2013. Tell me what your first impression was about Israel.
I was surprised that Israel was so modern. I think most people have in their mind what it's going to look like, a third world country, and not the modern country that it is. And it's so impressive because they're so far advanced in so many different things, in their farming skills, in their medical. It's just amazing what their medical technology and things is, and in technology fields. They're so far advanced of the United States in a lot of different ways that I
right.
was definitely surprised at that.
And the other thing that I wanted to say, Father, is so we felt very safe there. You haven't been to Israel, and we're so excited that you're going. And actually, we're going in November. And we're going also to Rome, right?
Correct. I'm excited about going, too.
Yeah, and you studied in Rome for 3 years, am I correct?
Just two.
Two. I gave you an extra year.
I wish I had it.
That's right. So did you love Rome?
I did. Rome is a wonderful historic city. It's a biblical city as well, even though it's not part of the Holy Land.
Right.
St. Paul wrote a letter to the Romans, and
right.
According to tradition, St. Paul and St. Peter died in Rome.
That's right. And Pat, you know, what's amazing is that I've been also to Greece. So I've been to Rome, I've been to Greece, and I've been to Israel. So that's pretty exciting. And I'm hoping the next time we go, Father, besides this time, we go to Greece because it's really important, and to Turkey, because when you do Greece, you do Turkey as well. And that's where the Blessed Virgin and St. John went in the end. Now, let's talk a little bit about what we're doing on a pilgrimage and what we did in our travel so we can share it with Father.
Well, I think the first thing that we did when we were there was we had a specialized tour.
Yeah, we did.
They really rolled out the red carpet for us and considered us special guests. So we got to see things behind the scenes that a lot of people don't get to see. And one of the things we saw was the museums. I think more museums than most people get to go to. We saw the backside of the Sea of Galilee. When I say the backside, they took us out on a private boat, the three of us together, and we got to show how to fish and throw the nets over.
You get to do that, though.
Yeah,
you know that.
Yeah, we do it again, but yeah, not with just three people on
not,
the boat.
No, no.
We interviewed a doctor while we were there. We went to a Catholic
monastery.
Mission House monastery and interviewed a it was really interesting to me because there were like 13 priests that lived there and 20 nuns, and they were in the middle of a Muslim community. And I said, what do you guys do for like outreach? You know, how do you bring the people in? And he's like, well, we don't. And I'm like, really? What do you do? And he's like, we just stay here. We just pray. We just, you know, worship God. We don't do any outreach. And to me, being from America, everybody does outreach here. You know, you're always trying to get the masses to come into the churches so that you can tell them about Jesus.
But it was a monastery, right? It was a monastery. Tell her basically what most monks do. Besides, you know, go ahead.
Well, it depends on what kind of monk they are, but all of them pray the psalms. That's a very important thing, that the official prayer book for any monk is the psalms, because it's the inspired word of God, and it's, of course, the book of hymns of the Old Testament. So some monks, if there's a really strict observance, some of them pray all 150 within a day, at least within the church's history.
Wow.
That was the case. Others, over a full week, they end up praying the Psalms. Lighter schedules would be more like all 150 over a month or so, although certain Psalms are more seasonal, like certain ones are used around Lent and Easter time.
Right.
That wouldn't be used other times.
And I think they grow, if I remember correctly, they do vegetables and stuff
yes.
like that.
They're almost self-sufficient.
Right.
And they found a way to graft peaches on a citrus plant because the citrus plant roots are hardier and the branches are hardier, so the peaches could grow on a more sturdy branches. And they found ways to, I mean, just like interesting things that they were doing there.
Farming has always been an important part of the monastic tradition.
Right.
It's interesting that in such an exotic place like Israel that they'd be able to do exotic things like grafting peaches
yeah.
onto citrus. That's
and it's neat. Amazing. One of the things that I just learned recently is that in one of the valleys where nothing was growing before, the only thing they could possibly put in there was like, it's a desert area and they were irrigating it. And they have like 400 acres. And what they do is in the wintertime, they grow melons. But the roots of the melons weren't lasting. They just weren't sturdy enough. So they took squash plants. They plant the whole entire 400 acres with squash. And then they go back when they bud and they put watermelons and cantaloupes on that plant. And so then the root system supports a watermelon or a melon plant, and they grow the whole entire thing with melons because that's what the roots are then able to feed. They go down deeper. So the things that we found out are just fascinating, what they can do that I don't think of anybody that would ever do it here in the United States or how they would do it. So it's very interesting in their technology and the things that they do.
And you know, going on the Dead Sea was in seeing Masada, where King Herod, architectural, unbelievable,
amazing
what it felt like to be there and to actually experience it. Pat and Rick, her husband went, and you're going to love this. You got to bring your bathing suit. I don't know, November, maybe not. I don't know. You actually,
we were there in November?
We were?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We were swimming in November. Okay, so you're out on the Dead Sea, and it's a salt lake, basically. It's a dead lake, so it's got salt, so you get to do that. So that was pretty cool. But guess what? We need to take a short break, but what website do we want to go to so you can go with us?
You can find out so much more by going to www.tcbtl, thebiblecomestolife.com.
And right, you're going to have your event up on your website. Am I correct, Father?
Yes.
And that is, you want to give that?
You go ahead and say it.
It's stjosephparish.com.
Oh, that's our website. Actually, yes. It's St. Joseph North Bend.
StJosephNorthBend.com. Right. And also, go to the Facebook, which is the Bible Comes to Life.com. And the cool thing is that there's so many things that you can find on it in videos. And so we're going to take a short break, and we're going to be right back on Let's Just Talk. We're back on Let's Just Talk, and I know, Pat, that you want to talk about a piece of scripture that's really important. And then, Father, you know, one of the things that I love about Israel is to go to some of the churches and really see that. That's going to be so exciting for you. But if there's a scripture piece that you would like to say, or a psalm that you would like to say after Pat, that would be great. Go ahead, Pat.
Well, one of the things that I've been doing is since we're really studying now for The Bible Comes to Life and reading about Israel and studying the different things that we're going to see again when we go, I want to be more knowledgeable than I was the last time. And so I've been doing some research in it, and I found a scripture, and it was one of those scriptures that you say, oh my gosh, aha moment. And it's in Ezekiel, it's 20 verse 8, and it says, on that day I raised my hand in an oath to them to bring them out of the land of Egypt into a land that I had searched out for them, flowing with milk and honey, the glory of all lands. And I've heard often that he went to the land of milk and honey and all that. But when I saw this, that it was a land that God searched out for them, that was going to be the glory of all lands. It wasn't just any land. It was like an amazing place. And so then when I started doing the research on the flowing with milk and honey, which is what we always hear, I found out that the cows that are in Israel today produce more milk than any cows in the world, with no antibiotics and no growth hormone. And the honey that they're talking about is honey dates. And when they're fully ripe, they drip honey. And then the bees do pollinate and they get the honey from them. But I thought how interesting it is that this is not just a piece of property. It's not just a desert. It's the land that God searched out for his people. It has five growing seasons there. Five different zones where it grows from anything from bananas all the way up to apples and everything in between. They raise 98% of all their food.
And they export it too.
They export a lot, import hardly anything. Five crops that they import. So when I found out all this stuff, it's like, makes it more amazing than ever that right. We're going to go there again and see it. And to share it with people is just incredible to me.
And let's talk about the manna from heaven. You know, when the Israelites were going through this period where they were in the desert, the manna from heaven, Father, what does that refer to?
It refers to the special food that was said to appear every morning for them to collect. Mm-hmm. It was enough for everyone to have enough of it. If someone collected too much of it, they didn't have too much. And if someone didn't collect enough, they still had enough. And on the day before the Sabbath, every week they got a double portion of it then to last them through the Sabbath so that they didn't have to work on the Sabbath. And so it's this miraculous food.
Miraculous food. And what's, you know, there's so many things that we talk about through the readings and through the scripture. Which one do you love the best of what we've been talking about, or actually the Old Testament or New Testament? What is your favorite?
I would say my favorite book of the New Testament would be, or the Bible overall, would be the Gospel of Luke.
Right.
And in that, in the first couple of chapters, we hear the beautiful story of Jesus' birth, the Annunciation. That's all in the first chapter. And these wonderful canticles appear there. The canticle of Zechariah, when he's able to speak. He praises the Lord because his son John the Baptist will be the herald of the Messiah. And the canticle of Mary, when she goes to the house of Zechariah, the wonderful thing said there when her kinswoman Elizabeth addresses her. She praises the Lord with her, it's called the Magnificat in Latin. It means, my soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, is that first line. What a wonderful passage, and I'm looking forward to finding out, you know, being close to where those canticles the New Testament setting for those canticles.
And there actually is a place where we get to go to that was unearthed underneath a church where Mary received the notice that she was going to give birth to Jesus.
Oh, you get to go to the Annunciation.
It's incredible. The Church of the Annunciation is just spectacular.
And then also St. Peter's house, which we were really surprised. It was absolutely gorgeous.
There's so much there that you just can't imagine that it's, you know, lasted for 2,000 years, for one thing, or more. Mm-hmm. And to see and touch and feel it is one thing, and all the Bible stories that go along with it. But not only that, but when you see how miraculous the whole country is and the whole land, it's just an amazing place that God has prepared for his people.
And I think that, you know, we really need to understand our religion, number one.
Yes.
Okay. And, you know, through the Bible Comes to Life program, you do, because it's an education center, which I really, really like that idea.
I do too. I love it a lot.
Because not only do they do it with churches, with Christian and Catholic and every religion, actually, they do other things that excite you as well. I mean, just recently in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which we saw, mm-hmm. which I loved, it's so beautiful. Underneath the first, there's a piece of marble, and then there's another piece. And that's 1600 that was put in.
They just unearthed it, right.
And they just unearthed it, and they found the original.
That they think.
They think that they found, which they're really excited about.
One of the things that we found when we were over there is they don't tell you any place that you go, this is the spot where Jesus was born, or this is the spot where Jesus died. Because if they did, it would just turn into a shrine, and it would be not what God had intended. If he wanted us to know the exact locations, we would know where it was. But he has kind of left it so that we can assume that this is what it is because of the things around it or because of the history of the building or whatever it is. But he doesn't ever say, this is the exact spot where Jesus was crucified, or this is the exact spot where something happened, because they're assuming that that's what it is based on biblical history, what they think it is. So I thought that was pretty interesting.
Which when you go over, it was totally different than I ever imagined it would be. And there's different churches and stuff that actually take over certain areas and for a little while, and then the other ones take it over. I mean, it was amazing when we went to where the British, remember the place that we went to where they said it was the Garden Tomb. And then the Catholic side or the other Christian side says, no, this is it.
Yeah,
it's over
the evangelical
here.
Side mm-hmm. is right. one part, and then the Catholic part. But it was really Greek Orthodox to begin with,
right.
and then the Catholic part of it.
That was so weird to mm-hmm. us, right? And but we really, we got to go to the Wailing Wall.
Yes, which is amazing.
Absolutely.
And to think that the Palestinians are trying to say that the Christians have no connection with, or the Jewish people have no connection with it at all. And that's really what they're fighting about, is they want everything there, that there is no connection at all with the temple, that there's nothing that ever says that that's where the Jews had their temple or anything else. And it's like, oh my gosh, walk over there and touch it. There's still the wall left. So that's the part that just amazes you. And when you go through the whole country, you can see why they fight with each other, because it's this one wants this one wants that. It's like children bickering back and forth. And we really noticed that a lot as far as what their cultures are requiring and requesting.
Go ahead, Father.
Yes, lots of long historical debates and and fights.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it was amazing to me after, what did you think? Remember, we did talk about this on the show. The movie Risen was so well done. And when I saw that, Father, and I thought back to Israel,
yes.
and I thought to myself, oh my gosh, this is so...
We were there. We walked there.
So you're going to get to walk there, which is really amazing. And I can imagine with the Sea of Galilee, and everybody really knows, I hope, that it's a lake. And on that note, we need to take a short break. But go to Father's website, which is
stjosephnorthbend.com.
Right. And the
www.tcbtl.com.
And Don't forget to go to
Facebook,
the Bible Comes to Life .com, and we will be back after these messages. We're back on Let's Just Talk. And, you know, we were talking about the Sea of Galilee and how important it actually was and what happened on the Sea of Galilee. So I know that you want to mention something about it, but I want Father to talk about it too, because it's really important. Go ahead, Pat.
At one point, the Sea of Galilee was the only fresh water in all of Israel. And what is amazing about it is that it's fed with saltwater spring. So the whole bottom of the lake is saltwater. And then the top of it is all the runoff and the rain that comes down off of the mountains. And the top of it is all freshwater. So when we were there, they had just come out of a drought season, and there was signs all over the lake and all the little cities that we went to saying there's only so many feet of fresh water left. And if it goes underneath it, then it would ruin the whole lake and it would be salinized. But the way it is that they can fish on the top part of the water, and then they get freshwater fish. They can drop baskets into the bottom part, and they get saltwater fish, which I thought was just amazing. In addition to that, now it is not just the only freshwater, but it is the largest freshwater lake in all of the Middle East. And if you look on a map, an overview of it, you'll see it. It's 13 miles long and 9 miles wide. So one of the biggest places. But now they have water reclamation all over the state, so they're not using it completely for it anymore. But still about 20% of all freshwater comes out of the Sea of Galilee.
Now, Father, why is the Sea of Galilee so important to Christians and to Catholics and to evangelicals? Why is it so important in our history?
Well, it's so important because in the New Testament, so much of the action happens there. Right. Simon and Andrew, the two brothers, and James and John, the two brothers, that is where they did their fishing. And it's along that shore that Jesus walked along and called them to be his disciples. Also, the miraculous catches of fish, a theme through the Gospels, as well as the walking on water by Jesus and by St. Peter. As long as Jesus was summoning him, he walked on the water until his lack of faith made him start to sink, right. And Jesus helped him in. But so those wonderful, interesting scenes are there. And again, you mentioned the movie Risen, that beautiful scene after the resurrection, when yes. the Lord is on the on the shore, and they make that wonderful catch mm-hmm. of fish. It's so dramatic. You know, that's a point where I thought, wow, I really would like to be on that lake where it all happens.
So there's a Holy Land. There's a restaurant called St. Peter's Fish that you can go eat.
Well, it's called the Dex. It's called the Dex.
No, there's a
different one. Oh, there's another one.
There's
a different
fish. Yeah. The right. fish themselves are called St. Peter's
that's
fish,
right.
too. There's
right.
a certain
yes.
kind of fish. Sometimes if they show fish on a stained glass window and someone did a lot of research, they show that particular type of fish.
And it makes sense that Jesus did all the things there, and he recruited his disciples there because so many villages were built around the only fresh water that there was.
That's right.
So
mm-hmm.
there's tons of villages that were at one time there, and some of them still are, and then some of them have gone away, and you can go to the ruins of it. So you get to see a lot of interesting things when you go there.
Go ahead.
He also taught the crowds from the lake.
Right.
In a couple of scenes, he also he would use the lake as a route of escape from the crowds sometimes, and he calmed the storm on that lake. Mm-hmm. You know
right.
so many of those scenes so important. So there's the Holy Land, but then there's that lake in the middle. It's not the land part, but
it's the lake.
How wonderful the Sea of Galilee.
You get to go to the Mount of Beatitudes, which is there, and they have a wonderful tribute
yeah.
that's just amazing. That has rocks that have carved the Beatitudes all the way up to the steps, and you can see it. Blessed are the poor in spirit, and the different things that are there. So it's just it's an incredible monument.
It really is. And the other thing that amazed me is that at the Sea of Galilee, we are going to go to the Dex restaurant. And the lady that owns the Dex restaurant also owns Olive Groves. And actually, she's a really, really sweet gal. And those are her boats, I found out, that go out onto the Sea of Galilee. She owns all that. And we actually had the fish, St. Peter's fish, while we were there, and a lot of other things.
A lot of things.
A lot of things. And I actually got to do a cooking show with her father, nice. Which was really a lot of fun, because that way, you know, it was really interesting meeting her sons who help her run the restaurant. And it's packed every night.
Yes.
Every night it's packed. But she's a delight to work with, and she's very, very sweet. I mean, I think the food in Israel was so fresh. It was so good that you could put on 10 or 15 pounds mm-hmm. easily. We know.
But we
Rick
walked
did.
A lot.
Okay, but we walked a lot. So bring comfortable shoes.
Yes.
Very important. I do want to mention that we are so privileged to have the CEO of The Bible Comes to Life coming to see us here in the tri-state on March the 3rd through the 5th. And Omer Eshel is his name. He is the CEO of The Bible Comes to Life. He actually wrote the program, The Bible Comes to Life, actually was his program. He worked for the tourism board as a diplomat, and he was the actual Midwestern manager of the whole Midwest, director of the tourism, travel and tourism for Israel. And that's how I met him, as a travel agent, and actually did a TV show with him, and we became friends. And for 4 years, he was in, actually in Chicago, and wrote the program in Chicago and took it around the country. And so when he went back to Israel, he decided that he was going to leave the government and actually start the program. And he went
Institute.
The Institute, yeah. the actual Bible Comes to Life Institute, which is part of the Talem Group, mm-hmm. and which is the oldest education center in Israel, only one right now. And they do the other part of the program, and they do all of the tours, but they also do Birthright, which means that anybody that's Jewish, 18 to 26, goes to Israel. It's their birthright. They go for free. So, and then the other thing I want to mention is that the actual tours that we're going to be going on, you have to have, they have to have at least 20 people.
Yes.
And two people then go
for free.
For free.
Tour leaders.
Tour leaders go for free. And you can make money on the tours mm-hmm. for your church.
For ministries.
For ministries, whatever
it may be.
It's a
wonderful thing for nonprofits.
And great for nonprofits.
They can make some money for their charity or their
right.
organization by doing that.
Right. And, you know, I think it's important. Everybody that we know that has been can't wait to go back.
It's actually the trip of a lifetime.
Really.
It really is.
Really is. And the people that we met, and after the break, I'm going to show you a book, and I'm going to share it with Father, because he's going to get to hopefully meet him. But we're starting this in Lent, Father, right? This program, March the 3rd through the 5th, is right after Ash Wednesday, am I correct?
Weekend after Ash Wednesday, yes.
Right, it's Thursday, and he'll be here through Sunday. And the first event is going to be at your wonderful church.
Yeah, at St. Joseph in North Bend, a Thursday evening lecture. I think we've got it
right.
tentatively scheduled for 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock, right. And anybody that would like to come, we would love to have you, right?
Yes, yes. It's a free lecture on the Bible by this Omer Eshel,
right.
this great Bible scholar, a Jewish man filled with faith and very respectful of the Christian faith.
I actually asked him if he was a Messianic Jew when I talked to him one day on the phone.
And he told you what?
He said, I have not completely abandoned my Jewish heritage, but if Christ were alive today, I would be a follower.
That's pretty good.
Yeah,
he actually
good.
Is. He's really wonderful.
Yeah, he's amazing.
And also, he's an archaeological scholar mm-hmm. as well. And we need to take a short break, and we'll be right back. And where do we want to go to get information?
TCBTL, thebiblecomestolife.com.
And the Facebook is The Bible Comes to Life. Don't forget to go up and look at all the events. And we'll be right back on Kathryn Raaker's Let's Just Talk. We're back on Let's Just Talk, and we're here with Pastor Korb and Father Andrew Umberg, who is my pastor from St. Joseph Church, and my friend and author and travel liaison, Pat Sternkorb. I have to tell you that this book, this cookbook, has really been a solid gold thing for me because we not only got to meet him, but I want to just read a little piece from here. Legendary restaurateur Uri Bui or Uri Bui takes his readers on an in-depth journey into the world of fish and seafood. He presents information, ideas, recipes, and variations while sharing his culinary worldview. Uri teaches readers how to select fish and seafood and how to check for freshness and how to clean, store, and freeze it. He also details the various methods for preparing fish and seafood, including grilling, roasting, curling, pickling, smoking, frying, stewing, and steaming, baking, and more. Through an abundance of recipes, Uri combines different cooking traditions with the spectrum of taste, preparation methods, and local ingredients found along the shores of the Mediterranean. I have to tell you that he is the top restaurant in the Middle East. He just won this acclaim. And his palace, which is called what, Pat?
The Effendi Hotel, is amazing.
And you want to tell us a little bit about it for Father so he
yes.
knows?
So this is in a Muslim neighborhood. Akko is a Muslim community predominantly, and that's where his restaurant is, and it's right on the Sea of Galilee. On the Mediterranean. And so he has this palace right down the street from his restaurant, and it's called the Effendi Hotel. And what it was a dilapidated palace. And so he rebuilt the palace and started redoing it. It took him 8 years to redo it, and millions of dollars, literally millions of dollars. So every room in it, and it's a huge building, every room has hand-painted ceilings that has murals on them.
Or frescoes.
Yes. And so every one they've redone, they had people come in from all over the world, artists from all over the world to redo them. But in the corner of every single one of them is the original colors that they matched because they didn't have the same kind of paint we had. And they have wooden detail around each one of them. And every single room has these gigantic, as big as like 12 by 15 or whatever, huge murals. There's steps that are all solid marble. There's gold inlay in the big rooms that they have. And then in the basement, he said it was under 40 feet of rubble. They had no idea there was anything down there. And they unearthed this gigantic wine cellar. Has arched ceilings in it. It's the most amazing thing you've ever seen. And I said, do you live here? And he said, I can't afford to live here.
The funny
but
part,
it's amazing.
And the funny part about it is, Father, that it's in this Crusader town.
Yes.
And there's a church there, too,
there
isn't
is.
There, that
yes.
we visited.
Yep.
And the name of the church, do you remember?
I don't remember.
We'll get it for you,
it
Father.
It was St. Peter's.
Worry.
It was the St. Peter's church because it had.
Yes.
Yeah. Thing. I have it in my scrapbook.
Right. And, you know, that's one of the places that we're going to probably visit because it's really important in church history as well. But we went there at night. We had no idea where we were going for dinner.
Right.
And we walked into this place and I went, you got to be joking.
Yeah. It sees like a dozen people.
That's it. And then he said, come on with me, since you're friends of Omer's.
Yeah.
Come with me, and we're going to take you to the palace.
And it was like literally 11 o'clock at night when we
right.
went there.
Or right.
later. And then we were there for, 2 hours at least.
Right, right. And he said, you can come back and stay with us. And Patty and I are going to actually take him up on that someday.
Yeah, that would be great.
Because I think that the actual rooms were like $1,500
yes,
a night
were.
Or something like that. And it's rated on the travel guide 4 stars. He hasn't hit 5
it's
yet.
It's incredible.
I think
it's
it
incredible.
Should be 5 stars,
yeah, I
actually.
So
I think so, too. And he's such a lovely man.
Yeah.
He comes to the States all the time and teaches. And he wants to do a cooking show with you, Father.
That would be quite an honor.
That would be an honor, right? Well, Father actually is a wonderful chef, I think. Right?
Well, thanks. I think I do okay.
He does okay.
You
love to cook.
A whole different league, but yeah, I do love to cook.
You love to cook, and we love having him on The Chef, you and I. So this is going to be an experience. The food alone is going to be an experience. The wines in Israel, of course, she doesn't imbibe. She doesn't drink at all, but I do, and not a lot. but they were so beautiful. And they do, one of the places, wineries that
Tishbe,
we stopped.
Tishbe Winery.
Tishbe Winery.
Which is in the Golan Heights.
In the Golan Heights. We had chocolate. We did a wine tasting with chocolate. Very expensive chocolate. And then we went to where they have the honey, where the hives where we did the honey. We did limoncello.
Yep. That was at the monastery.
That was at the monastery. And so it's not just a religious, you know, thing that you get to see how, you know, how originally when they first came back to repatriate Israel, they actually put so much time and effort into turning the desert into a fertile land again.
It's incredible. They actually have about 4,000 acres that is under something. So it's their greenhouses. So they're under tents, they're under glass, and you can see them all down miles and miles and miles of greenhouses and covered areas where they're growing pineapple and avocado and coconuts all along the Mediterranean. It's all undercover. Bananas. It's amazing what they do.
One time when I was in Rome, I was visiting a priest there in town, and it was February, and they had these big grapes the size of golf balls. And he says, this isn't the season for grapes in Europe. I think these came from Israel.
Yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah, incredible.
Right, and it's just amazing. The olives there are so delicious. Everything you taste has a different taste to it. And, you know, we're going to experience two meals a day there. And you go, two meals? Really? Two meals is a lot, isn't it?
It is a lot. And a lot of times, if you're hungry, I mean, they had places you could snack. One day we had fresh hummus and fresh pita, like
delicious.
Right out of the oven, which was incredible. And another day we had pomegranate smoothies. So there's things along the way. It's not like they starve you to death for lunch, but there's places that you can eat. And it's
because you have a big
great.
Breakfast. Yeah. That's what happens. You have a big breakfast, and it's a European breakfast type. But they also had, in a lot of these hotels that we stayed at or places we stayed at, they have it's
fresh fruit,
Western, you know, style. So you really don't go to Israel. No, but you do a lot of walking. So that makes up for all that you eat, right?
Yes, it does.
It does. What do you think was, you know, one of the things that I hope we get to do, even as a side trip, maybe. Was to go to the Holocaust Museum. That
It's on almost every tour because we're going to in May because we're going in May with a group and we're going to the Holocaust Museum. And
you're going to the Children's...
We are.
Yeah, the Children's Museum where it's all mirrors and candles.
And it's based on the children that were killed
million
in the Holocaust.
Children
yeah.
in the Holocaust. And it's one of the most... I had tears in my eyes after I left. Anybody that thinks that there wasn't a Holocaust.
Right.
I mean, the pictures, the museum, it's really well. But the other thing I wanted to tell you about is the scrolls.
The Dead Sea Scrolls. They're there. They actually were in the United States, and Omar was the one that traveled with them throughout the United States.
Right.
So he got to experience that. But they're all kept in a special museum.
That's right.
And the museum is actually... has water flowing over it all the time. It's like in a big dome. It looks like an onion. And fountains of water come on to keep it cool so that they can keep the temperature inside it, a constant temperature so that they never heat up. And they're all under glass and all protected. Otherwise, they would just disintegrate.
That's right.
And so all of these fountains of water going up, and it's just like, it really does look like a giant onion sticking up out of the ground.
And on that note, we need to take a short break, and we'll be right back. And we're going to have Father Talk. Okay, we'll be right back after these messages. We're back on Let's Just Talk. And Father, we were talking about the Dead Sea Scrolls. And I know you got a chance to what?
I got to go to the exhibit, the Dead Sea Scrolls exhibit that I guess it toured the whole United States, but it came to Cincinnati, and I made sure, since I have the master's in scripture, I wanted to go down and see that for myself. It really was a beautiful display, very well done. Interesting to know that the person that we're working with on this trip was the one who was the official guide to that.
Right.
And that is wonderful. You know, those Dead Sea Scrolls, a lot of people thought, when they discovered these, that they were going to find out all kinds of major variations, you know, with regard to Scripture. But in fact, it affirmed the fact that the text tradition, that is, the handing out down of the Hebrew manuscripts, which was done very much by a certain sector of the Jews, kept the whole thing very accurate.
And we saw the caves where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found.
By young boys. And they wore them. They wore the Dead Sea Scrolls as shoes for a while.
And they told the people they dropped rocks into a hole and they were trying to see what was down in it. And they kept hearing things break. And it was the pots that the Dead Sea Scrolls were in where they had hid them.
You know, the oldest full edition of the Bible that would include the New Testament as well is known as the manuscript is known as Sinaiticus, and was it discovered by a German archaeologist in the 19th century at the Sinai Monastery. I think it was St. Catherine's in Sinai, and he found they were covering jars with a piece of paper, like using it like old newspaper. And he said, let me see that. And he found out that this was part, stack they were getting it from. So it's the oldest complete scripture manuscript that we have, that the church has, containing the full New Testament.
So when you went to see the Dead Sea Scrolls, could you read them?
I could read a letter here and a letter there and sometimes see Israel or, just a couple of key words, because the script is a little bit different than what I had learned studying Hebrew in the seminary.
Right. Oh, cool.
So we want to talk about Jerusalem since we're almost out of time here. So let's just touch on Jerusalem.
So one of the highlights, I think, of our trip was we traveled around from Tel Aviv. We went north through Israel. We came back down through Galilee. And then on like the fourth day, I think, or the fifth day, we went into Jerusalem. And of course, Jerusalem is the holy city. And so I've been reading this book called Jerusalem. That's an autobiography of Jerusalem that Omar actually sent me. And one of the things that is said in there is this is the only city that is an earthly city and a heavenly city. So it's going to be eternal forever. It was before we had our Bible. Obviously, it was there forever. But in Revelation 21:1-3, it says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And so it is an earthly and heavenly city, so it's eternal. It's the only eternal city that's going to be fully earthly, that you can touch and feel, and fully celestial, which I thought was just like amazing when you really stop and think about it. So it's an eternal city.
Right.
So when we went into Jerusalem, obviously we got to see a lot of important things, the Wailing Wall, the rocks. We went underneath the wall and took a tour of the, not catacombs, but just the tunnels that go underneath, and saw the largest rocks. And you have to say, how in the world did they ever move these rocks to get in here?
And that was really surprising.
Oh my gosh,
it was
incredible. So many holy places in Jerusalem that you get to see. But then you also get to see life in the city and what it's like and where most of the Jews live. Like 800,000 people live in Jerusalem. So it's a huge city, bigger than you would imagine, and everything is made out of limestone. It's a law that it has to be made out of limestone. If it's made out of wood, it has to have a limestone facade on it. So things like that that you don't find out until you get there. And it was so interesting.
It really was. And, you know, Father, I think Jerusalem's going to be a really exciting place for you.
Oh, I'm sure it is. I'll be seeing a lot of things for the first time.
For the first time. And, you know, you can come back and then you can relate it to everything that you do every day, or in, especially on Sunday when we're listening to your wonderful sermons and the New Testament and the readings. I mean, I think the readings mean so much more to me as a lector today than they ever did before, because I've been to those places, both in Turkey, Greece, and Israel. So it makes sense.
It does.
And, you know, it's amazing how far they went on donkey.
Yes.
And how they did it.
Yes.
That amazed me so much. But there's a city, I have to tell you, in Jerusalem, they have a miniature city.
Yes, that's at the Museum of Israel.
That's the Museum of Israel. Is that in Jerusalem?
It's in Jerusalem.
It's in Jerusalem. And it shows the whole city at the time of
Christ, rebuilt in miniature, but it's probably the size of a football field. So you stand up on this wall and you can look down in it, and all of the buildings are there, and the temple is there, and all of the little cities around it, and or all the little communities around it, and houses. It's the most amazing thing you've ever seen. All the topography is accurate, so you can see right where it comes down out of the hills and goes into the valley before it goes to Gethsemane. It's just the most amazing piece of art that you've ever seen in your life. We walked around there for probably 2 hours, just looking at it and amazed at all the different ways that they have done it and what they've created. It's just incredible.
I mean, we couldn't believe some of the sites at all, because I mean, I couldn't walk anymore, and they had to go up to the Wailing Wall, because I was just so exhausted.
Well, that wasn't the Wailing Wall. So there's a wall. There's a museum park there, and it has a piece.
Not there. I'm not talking about that one. You climbed the wall.
Yeah, we climbed the wall.
But at the Wailing Wall, I had to sit down. Oh. I couldn't do it anymore because you need to wear really comfortable shoes.
There's another piece of the wall, though, that's of the old city of Jerusalem. It's in the old city.
Right.
And so you can climb up and walk along the actual top of the old wall. And it looks down into the city of David and looks down across the valley. It's just incredible. But we had to climb up probably, 150 feet, and then walk all along this wall and down. It was amazing.
Just amazing. So what the most important thing is, because we're running out of time, you need to go to the T, like Tom, the Bible Comes to Life, .com is TBCTL.com. And you can see all the videos, and you can be excited about going. And you know what? We are going so affordably.
Yes.
Because we're going through the education center, we've cut out the middleman. Mm-hmm. And you know, if this is a trip of a lifetime, it really is. It's our pilgrimage to go back to be with Christ. Mm-hmm. And we're starting it during Lent, which I'm really excited about, actually. And Father and I are going November of this year. Correct, Father?
Correct. That's when our big trip will be.
Our big trip.
So and this is an opportunity.
An opportunity for you. And you're going in May?
We're going in May. Yes. We're excited
about that. And Pat's going with friends and family.
Friends and family.
Right?
Yep.
So you can go either with your pastor, mm-hmm. or you can go with friends and family. If you want to go on an archaeological tour, you can do it all.
Yes.
Right? And I just want to mention that we have different events listed up on our website.
Facebook page, on the Facebook page.
And Father's going to have the event for St. Joe's, which is March the 4th, right, on our website.
Yes, with Omar Eshel there.
And also our trip to go to Israel and Rome. That'll be up there in a few weeks. Right, Father?
Yes, we'll have a posting with basic information.
Right. And we can't thank you enough for joining us. And I can't thank you enough, both of you, for joining us on Let's Just Talk. And please come and visit and come to the events that we're going to have March 3rd through the 5th. And it'll be posted up on the website.
It's already on Facebook.
Right. And thank you so much. You've been wonderful. And we'll see you next time on Let's Just Talk.